Chapter 11, Caloric Bankruptcy.
I had always questioned the New Jersey t-shirts that claim only the strong survive, but after that weekend, I clearly understood the slogan. There will always be a place in my heart for the Garden State. I just hoped that I would never have to see it again. The past 7 days had been the longest and most painful of my life. However, what was living hell for me might have actually been an answered prayer for others. In the proper context, I can see how weight loss is very similar to religion. The further you push it upon someone who is not ready or willing to receive it, the further you actually push them away. However, when the heart of the afflicted is broken enough to actively seek redemption, well then true transformation will be sought out. Our vacation not only left me broken, but it also removed the proverbial veil from my eyes. I could no longer ignore the consequences of my actions. Clearly, there were a lot of changes that needed to be made in my life. Fortunately, the 8-hour ride home provided plenty of time to consider every available option. I always romanticized a gastric bypass approach for weight loss. The idea of losing mass quantities of weight while doing little to no exercise always warmed my heart. But in my case, I couldn't justify the risk. I had the rest of my life ahead of me, and the possibility of losing it on the operating table because I'd rather take a scalpel to the abdomen than a lap around the track. Realistically, it would have taken less effort to commit to a gym for a year than it would have to deal with an entire post-op, physical therapy, and reconditioning that I would have to endure while rehabbing my surgically pieced together midsection. So, I could suffer without stitches or a copay, or I could suffer with a myriad of scars, complications, and traumas. I don't know about you, but my mother always said that being stabbed is a bad idea, even if it's at the hands of a professional. Joking aside, my stomach wasn't really the problem. My stomach was merely the visual sign that I wouldn't stop eating. I didn't understand what full was, and somehow along the way, an overstuffed stomach had become associated with romance, and no amount of surgery was going to fix that. Truthfully, if I did have the bypass without taking care of my mental dependencies, then it would have only been a matter of time until I pushed my stomach back out again. For me, bypass was a bad option, and it would waste both time and money. Mentally, I moved on and began sizing up corporate weight loss options such as metabolic fast or West Coast weight loss. But after reviewing what they had to offer, I believed that none of them would work for me. My hesitation with them were this. Why are B-rate celebrities and former athletes selling me their product instead of success stories? Wouldn't you think if those spokespeople had better career opportunities, they would have taken them? Since it appeared that they didn't, I could only imagine the amounts of free time they had to devote solely to exercise. I mean, how much weight could I lose if it was my job? It just seemed like these programs cared more about selling products than they did providing weight loss solutions, which explained why their office job postings always required a degree in sales and business rather than health and wellness. How do I know this? Well, there is free internet in the library, and Career Constructor is one of the only sites that wasn't parentally controlled by the district. Plus, if I told Miss Thomas that I was doing career research for when I graduated, she didn't make me dust off the bookshelves when there were no books to return. Back to corporate weight loss. My mother had been on and off of Weight Observers so many times that even I lost track. The only thing I actually learned from their programs was how to manipulate their point system as much as I manipulated my parents. I always had to question why a program designed for permanent results and progressive independence also encouraged a lifetime membership. I mean, it seemed as though they were trying to grant me a degree that would expire the moment I stepped off of campus. So I ruled them out.
What about lap band? That idea seems solid.
Yeah, no, not really. It's just a non-permanent form of the bypass, which, once again, doesn't solve my problem.
You are running out of logical ideas.
I know. You're telling me. We still have 3 hours left to drive.
Well, how about illogical options?
Like what? Those pills again? That's stupid. You saw how that ended up. I became cranky, I developed insomnia, then when that didn't work, I lashed out at others. No, I think if I'm going to buy into some form of corporate lie, I will buy into the "you can do whatever you set your mind to" lie.
How is that a lie?
Because it is. I have tried for years to lose weight, and all it did was yo-yo back and forth, leaving me even fatter than when I started. It is a statement that promises hope and delivers failure.
Wait. Tried for years to lose weight? No, that's the exact opposite of what you have done. Jeremy, you could write a book about all the times you ran away from weight loss and did something ridiculously drastic to avoid it. As far as failure, Jeremy, failure implies that you have tried something. You have never tried to lose weight. Ever.
Oh, that's not true. What about...
Ever.
Are you always trying to be a downer?
No, Jeremy. You always do this. You get so caught up in the latest and the greatest to the point that you waste all of your time preparing to start, but you never actually start anything. That is why a statement like, you can do whatever you set your mind to, bothers you. It's because all you see are empty promises without results. What I see is you getting so excited about what could happen that you never commit the time to make it happen. It's this perpetual cycle of you about to start, but you never do. So you really haven't failed at anything. It's just you've never really tried hard enough to actually begin anything.
I don't know. I mean, is that really what's going on here?
Yeah, basically. You just don't see it because you're living it. But I, as a part of your subconscious, get to see it all, as well as the motives. Think of me like a critic. I don't actually contribute anything of substance. I merely make fun of the failures of those who do. The beauty is if you take that failure, or lack of even trying, and you use it as passion to prove others wrong, then you will accomplish things greater than you ever imagined.
Huh. Well, I guess that logic rules out all these fake diet pills and fads. And knowing me, books probably won't work. I mean, really, who gets anything substantial out of a weight loss book anyways? Most of them are shelved in personal growth sections, which is ironic because it's not our inability to grow that has us seeking a book on weight loss in the first place. What is the solution there, overly critical subconscious?
Logic, Jeremy. Logic. Take all of the things that have put you in this state and seek out the exact opposite. You don't know the first thing about eating right. So find someone who does. You sneak food in ridiculous amounts. Surround yourself with accountability. You don't exercise because you don't know how. Find someone who does. Learn from them. Jeremy, weight loss is not rocket science, but making it mean something to you is.
So basically what you're saying is if I stop chasing safety and actually apply myself for once, I can achieve these great things?
Yeah.
While in that moment it sounded a whole lot like, you can do whatever you set your mind to. However, hearing it from a different voice gave me a perspective of validity that I felt it had been lacking. Maybe my mind was playing tricks on me during that car ride, but I felt as though weight loss might actually be attainable. By the time I was ready to lay my head down and catch a quick car nap, we were almost in our driveway. While unpacking the luggage, I asked my parents if we could have a town hall meeting the next day to discuss the life changes that I felt needed to occur. They cordially agreed, and for once in my life, I went to bed with a defined sense of purpose and a desire to embrace tomorrow. Once the sunrise gave way to the mid-morning sunlight, I rolled out of bed for the lunchtime meeting with my parents. Sitting down over a nice bologna sandwich and a side of conviction, we discussed the lower points of the vacation and what we felt could be learned from them. It took nearly a half an hour of deliberation to conclude that any weight loss of mine would need professional intervention. Sharing my feelings and satire with them on corporate weight loss programs, they assured me that we would seek out a physician-supervised, medically sound program. My options were plenty, but my parents decided to schedule an appointment with a bariatric weight loss center. As the week drew to a close, I found myself in their Squirrel Hill offices to meet with their staff. We went over the normal formalities, why I was there, what I hoped to learn from this experience, how many days a week I planned to weigh in. Once the informational meetings were wrapped up, we began to discuss my weight loss meal plan. As a part of my overall health, my water consumption needed to increase from almost nothing to 84 ounces a day. A B vitamin complex was administered to jumpstart my metabolism. The biggest component of my program would focus on exercise to burn away the fat that I had packed on for so long. By the end of the first week, I had lost 9 pounds. After the second week, I was down another 10. By the first day of school, I was almost under 300 pounds. I couldn't believe the success I was having. Everything worked flawlessly until the politics of the social lunchroom reminded me that life still had no place for the overweight, not even those seeking reform. While waiting in line, I noticed a familiar smell of scented body sprays mixed with the greasy mystery meat. Was it a burger? Was it meatloaf? Was it avoidable? I wasn't sure, but I was about to find out. Approaching the serving station, I asked the lunch lady if there was a healthier option than what was being served. Her eyes glared at me through her drooping hairnet as she sternly said, "You know, if you don't like what we're serving for lunch today, you can always go to yesterday's line and see if they have a sloppy joes left. And if that doesn't do it for you, then you're more than welcome to bring your lunch from home." But you see, that was part of the problem. Food designed to sit in a non-refrigerated environment for 4 hours was what helped me get fat to begin with. On top of that, there's no room for any of those preservative-filled, pre-packaged foods on my meal plan. So there I was, seeking something better for my health, and my best option was a poorly cooked replication of a cheeseburger. I mean, the cheese wasn't even melted. It was just lying there between the bun, and the meat looked like an unfirm handshake, useless and limp, almost pouting. I walked away from the line and over to my lunch table. I put my head in my arms and began to contemplate. It was no wonder why I was as fat as I was. My options were terrible. I mean, I never expected 4 ounces of baked chicken served with 6 ounces of steamed asparagus, but when a fat kid has to argue with the lunch lady to get a salad, there's clearly a flaw in the system. Maintaining my meal plan seemed like an exercise in futility. The first 2 months were great because I had complete control over my food as well as my schedule, but now I was at the mercy of the Czar of Lunch Lady Land. I did everything and anything possible to get my mind off of that day's failure. As I took my lunch lady's advice a little more personally than I should have, I began to think how I could make my allotted food work within the confines of a packed lunch. I tried my best to eat the 5-hour locker-inhabited vegetables, but I just didn't have the patience, or the stomach, for lukewarm, soggy carrots. I began to skip meals, and even worse, binge on standard school lunches. All of my inconsistencies began a cycle where I would gain a pound and lose 2, gain 4 pounds, lose 6. After having initial success, there seemed to be no way to sustain any weight loss program. I just didn't have the freedom I need to be loyal to it. Maybe in another life or so when I had the freedom of schedule, but at that moment, I just couldn't do it.
And so you're quitting again. I knew you would. Pansy.
What?
You heard me.
How can you even say that? You of all people have a first-hand view of the fact that I have no control over this.
Yes, you cannot control the fact that one of 1,000 doctor-recommended weight loss programs doesn't fit into your circumstances. But you do have the control over the fact that you're choosing to quit rather than use the brain that God gave you for something other than destroying your life.
So, what exactly are you suggesting?
Jeremy, I've said it before and I will say it again. Weight loss is not rocket science. Weight loss, at its core, is a numbers game. It is no different than getting out of debt. You need to eat less and you need to do more. The problem is that the human condition that got us here has made the space between being ready to accept that truth and being ready to act upon it so insurmountable that it is never surmounted. You, on the other hand, are the exact opposite. You are ready to lose weight and want a structured program, but the 1 in 1,000 that you have to follow doesn't work into your schedule right now. Jeremy, the honest truth is that you will always face obstacles, but as a counterpoint, you will always have a weight loss solution that will work for you. You just have to realize it. What you need to do is take the program the doctor has given you and stop asking, what can I eat? And start asking, why are they making me eat this?
And with that bit of shared wisdom, sarcasm, and momentary flashback, my subconscious was absolutely right. It was time to stop asking the what's and start asking the why's. One of the most convenient things about being a high school senior was the amount of unnecessary downtime I had. I never realized just how much my day was wasted by staring aimlessly at a wall. I figured instead of looking busy and wasting time, I would actually get busy and seize it. I began to analytically pick apart my weight loss program. I researched the food that were on my okay list and compared them with foods I used to eat. I started a list of all the behaviors I practiced prior to my program and all of the changes that were mandated. I counted calories, grams, and ounces, which, by the way, how did OZ become the abbreviation for ounce? I mean, there's not even a Z in the word. That doesn't make sense, and it doesn't even matter. What mattered was that I came up with a solution for my obesity problem. How so? I applied common sense to all areas of my life. I started to monitor exactly what I was consuming. The first thing I did was I started a journal. In that journal, I created a nutritional budget. For me, it was an act of accountability. If I was going to eat it, I was going to have to write it. And if I had to write it, I would have to explain it. And those pages acted as a resolution of my freedom or a diary of shame. Either way, though, it was honest. I began to look at weight loss as a path of least resistance. Could I eat whatever I wanted to? Sure. But I also had to admit to myself that I couldn't expect to lose weight with a weight maintenance mentality. Was a ball of mountain precipitation permissible? Yes, absolutely. But it was 400 calories, and in the grand scheme of things, that was as much of a full meal if I planned correctly. I consistently found myself asking the question, what is the path of least resistance? Is a ball of mountain precipitation worth having instead of an entire sandwich with carrots? Is an ice cream cone really worth an entire meal? It became a war of common sense rather than unattainable results. Finally, I was in control. Now, I know what you're thinking. Jeremy, I'm glad that calorie counted worked for you, but I just don't have the time, patience, or desire to do that. Okay, that's fair. I completely understand where you're coming from. However, let me ask you this. Do you count your money? Seriously, do you monitor how much money you have in your account versus how much debt you owe? Why do you do that? For me, the answer is simple. The amount of money one has controls the type of life one can live, right? Is it not living that allows one to be able to make money? Likewise, if your health-to-debt ratio runs out, so would your money, right? If you're dead or incapacitated due to weight, it hardly matters all the money you've collected. So it only makes sense to take care of what makes the money before you worry about counting your money. Bottom line, it was about taking responsibility for my actions and knowing what I was consuming instead of blindly stuffing myself. I took this mentality and I fully embraced it. Everything became a choice. I finally had a declaration of independence over food. I was no longer the victim. I was the one in control. I only wish I had thought like this earlier. How much of my life I have not wasted? Why are the simplest riddles the hardest to solve?